In this video, we're learning how to deal with relative velocities, and the point of relative motion is that we have a reference frame moving with respect to another reference frame, and we want to figure out how to transform the velocity of an object from one frame to the other. So in our example, we have an airplane moving 200 miles per hour to the north with respect to the air. In other words, the engines are capable of pushing the plane at 200 miles per hour through the air. But suppose we're also told the air is moving at 80 miles per hour to the east with respect to the ground. This causes an eastward drift of 80 miles per hour to the east. So even with a plane pointed due north, if the air is moving to the east, the plane is going to move on a northeast path with respect to the ground. And what we're trying to figure out is the net velocity of the plane with respect to the ground. To get clarity on the situation, it's helpful to think about displacements for a moment instead of velocity. So suppose we allow 1 hour to go by. Then the airplane moves 200 miles to the north with respect to the air, like this. But the air has also moved 80 miles to the east with respect to the ground, like this. So relative to the ground, the airplane has moved 200 miles to the north and 80 miles to the east, and these displacements naturally add as vectors. So our total northeast displacement is just the vector sum of this northward pointing 200 mile vector and eastward pointing 80 mile vector. And now we can get this displacement vector in polar form by using trigonometry. So the first thing we do is we say that the magnitude of the displacement is given by the Pythagorean theorem. So I take the square root of the sum of the squares of the legs. And when I run the numbers on this, I get about 215 miles for this displacement over the course of 1 hour. We also want to get the direction of the motion of this plane with respect to the ground. And we use the inverse tangent for that. That's the angle whose tangent is 80 over 200. And this gives me about 21.8 degrees. Now, since the plane traveled 215 miles with respect to the ground in 1 hour, that means its speed was 215 miles per hour. Now, what we've done here is totally equivalent to just adding the velocity vectors from the beginning. We take our northward velocity of the plane with respect to the air, that's 200 miles per hour. Our eastward velocity of the air with respect to the ground, that's 80 miles per hour. We add those velocity vectors head to tail, and notice that all the numbers in this right triangle are the same, so it's all going to come out the same. I get that V is 215 miles per hour, and that our angle with respect to the north is still 21.8 degrees, and that's the velocity of the plane with respect to the ground. So to compute relative velocities, we simply add velocity vectors, but it's really important the order you do this in. So I'm going to introduce a really useful notation here. The way I could summarize what we just did is like this. I can say the velocity of the plane with respect to the ground. That's how you read this notation. So I put a plane slash ground as a subscript. The velocity of the plane with respect to the ground is equal to the velocity of the plane with respect to the air, plus, and this is a vector sum, just as a reminder, the velocity of the air with respect to the ground. So to generalize this, I can use an O to stand for object. That's whatever object we're watching move within one of these reference frames. I can use an A for the first reference frame, and we'll call the second reference frame B. And so our general formula for adding relative velocities goes like this. The velocity of the object with respect to reference frame B is equal to the velocity of the object with respect to reference frame A, plus the velocity of reference frame A with respect to reference frame B. And just to clarify, in the example we worked with the airplane, the air was the first reference frame and it was moving with respect to the ground, which was the second reference frame. Now it's really important to have a general formula like this because the problems can quickly become very confusing. And to illustrate what I mean by confusing, here's a boat example with a boat crossing a river. So the water is a moving reference frame with respect to the shore, and we're going to have to deal with relative velocities. In the problem, we're told that we're standing on the shore and we observe a boat moving across a river with a speed of 10 meters per second with respect to the shore at an angle of 25 degrees with respect to the perpendicular. So this time we know the velocity with respect to the shore. We're also told the water is moving at 3 meters per second with respect to the shore. Okay, so we know how fast one reference frame is moving with respect to the other. And what I want to get this time is the velocity of the boat with respect to the water. In other words, the velocity with respect to the moving reference frame. So the problem is turned around a little bit. Finally, we want to state our answer for that velocity in polar form, meaning we need to get a magnitude and an angle. So we apply our general formula for relative velocities, and I have that the velocity of the boat with respect to the shore is equal to the velocity of the boat with respect to the water plus the velocity of the water with respect to the shore. And what we're solving for this time is the velocity of the boat with respect to the water. So I have to subtract the velocity of the water with respect to the shore from both sides. This is what I want. I want the velocity of the boat with respect to the water. That's equal to the velocity of the boat with respect to the shore minus the velocity of the water with respect to the shore. So I have to do a vector subtraction here, and to get that done, I'm going to break into components. First, the velocity of the boat with respect to the shore. Okay, so our y component of this velocity is given by the adjacent side of the right triangle that we formed here. So we're going to use the cosine function for that, and I get a 10 cosine 25. The opposite side of this right triangle, I've already translated that vector component down to where the boat was, and the opposite side uses the sine function. So I have a 10 sine 25 for that. Getting some approximate numbers on these, the y component is about 9.06, and the x component is about 4.23. And you can either write this in i-hat, j-hat notation. So like this, I could call this vector 4.23 meters per second in the x direction, in other words, i-hat, plus a 9.06 meters per second in the y direction, in other words, j-hat. Or you could just start making a list of what the x and y components are for the vectors in the subtraction problem. The other one we have to get is the velocity of the water with respect to the shore. And of course, that's a way simpler vector. It's just 3 meters per second pointing to the right. So it's 3 meters per second, I hat. And I'm subtracting my vectors here, so I need to subtract a 3 meters per second from the I hat component of the velocity of the boat with respect to the shore. And I don't do anything to the J hat or Y direction component because the water is moving perfectly horizontally. So I get the velocity of the boat with respect to the water. Again, that's going to be given by this vector difference, is given by 1.23 meters per second in the X direction, plus a 9.06 meters per second in the y direction. All right, and that's one way of writing the answer for the velocity of the boat with respect to the water. But in this problem, we were told to express it in polar form, so we have a little bit of trig left to do here. I'm going to visualize these components in a right triangle, where my x component is given by 1.23 meters per second, so 1.23 meters per second to the right. My y component is 9.06 meters per second, pointing up. And then my net velocity points up and to the right. And maybe it'd be nice to have an arrowhead on that guy because it's a vector. I'll call the magnitude little v, and then the angle of that vector theta. And what I mean by polar form is I need that magnitude v, in other words, the speed, and the angle theta giving me the direction. So to get the magnitude of this thing, I use the Pythagorean theorem. I take the square root of the sum of the squares of the legs, 1.23 squared plus 9.06 squared. And this gives me a speed of 9.14 meters per second. Finally, I use the inverse tangent function to figure out the angle. So this is the angle whose tangent is 9.06 divided by 1.23. And we get an angle of about 82.3 degrees. Again, theta is 82.3 degrees. Now there's one final note in this problem. The way we labeled our angle in the original picture, we labeled it with respect to the vertical, and it could be that you want to label your final answer that way as well. So all we have to do is put in a reference vertical like this, and I'll call that angle phi. And now phi tells us the direction of this boat with respect to the water, with respect to the vertical. Now phi is just 90 degrees minus theta, and 90 minus 82.3 is 7.7 degrees. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.